The next presentation is by Jeffrey Steinberg. Jeff is the counterintelligence editor of the Executive Intelligence Review. He is co-editor of at least two books, which he admits to having co-authored. One is Dope Incorporated. The other is The Ugly Truth About the ADL. And he will speak today on the subject of money laundering and sports. Jeff?
To repeat a central point that Mike Minichino just presented, through the medium of popular culture, especially the Hollywood entertainment industry, a communist international scheme, so to speak, hatched just a few years after the Bolshevik Revolution by people like Lukács, Adorno, Max Horkheimer, is on the verge of destroying the United States and much of Western civilization, of destroying our essential goodness, embodied in the Western Judeo-Christian notion of the sanctity of the individual soul. Ironically, this is taking place at the exact same time that the Berlin Wall has been torn down and the Soviet Union has collapsed. Communism may be dead and discredited for many people on the streets of Moscow, but in Hollywood, communism, in its Frankfurt School form, is not only alive and well, it's booming. It has become, in the closing decades of the 20th century, America's last remaining growth industry. The mass marketing of cultural pessimism and forced retardation has replaced scientific progress, technologically intensive manufacturing, and modern agriculture as the heart and soul of the American economy. Cultural subversion today is a multi-trillion dollar enterprise, and the executors of the Frankfurt School's cultural warfare are among America's wealthiest entrepreneurs. Just consider the following. Last year, the worldwide sale and distribution of radio, television, and film products generated $150 billion in revenue. About $40 billion of that reflected domestic sales here in the United States alone. Add on to that U.S. figure nearly $50 billion in sales of audio and visual equipment, $10 billion in sporting goods sales, $30 billion in toy sales, probably an increasing amount of that being adult toys of all sorts of unimaginable forms, $500 billion in legal casino gambling, and $50 billion spent on alcohol. That totals $680 billion spent on ostensibly legal, mind-deadening entertainment in the United States in 1992. And one can immediately add on another $40 billion passed directly into the hands of the ADL's friends in organized crime through illegal gambling in the United States last year. And of course, we have not yet even mentioned the $800 billion in sales last year of illegal drugs. About half of those sales occurred right here in the United States. 32 years ago, speaking at a conference sponsored by the United States State Department's U.S. Information Agency at the California Medical School in San Francisco, Aldous Huxley spelled out his future vision for America. And when I read this quote from Huxley, people should think back to the Pike-Mazzini dialogues and correspondence that Tony Chaikin talked about earlier. Huxley said at the U.S. government conference, quote, "There will be in the next generation or so a pharmacological method of making people love their servitude and producing dictatorship without tears, so to speak, producing a kind of painless concentration camp for entire societies so that people will in fact have their liberties taken away from them, but will rather enjoy it because they will be distracted from any desire to rebel by propaganda or brainwashing enhanced by pharmacological methods. And this seems to be the final revolution." What we have today with our multi-trillion dollar a year combined legal and underground entertainment industry in this country borders so close on Huxley's final revolution that it will take an extraordinary effort to turn back this new age onslaught. We are at the center of that effort, and I, for one, am optimistic that we can succeed. The task, nevertheless, is formidable. Here in America, in Western Europe, and increasingly in Eastern Europe and the territories of the former Soviet Union, this mass marketing of literally Sodom and Gomorrah is spreading like wildfire. The radio, TV, and film industry last year reported a growth rate of 15%. What auto, steel, or petrochemical firm could report such figures for fiscal year 1992? The gross profits from the sale of illegal drugs are doubling every 5 years. These dollar figures that I've been tossing around may seem a bit abstract, so let's do some comparison shopping and see what these sums of money are capable of purchasing. Let's just look at the defense budget, which is something that many politicians are very fond of hammering away at. Way back in 1978, when Lyndon LaRouche first commissioned the writing of the book Dope Incorporated, we determined that the gross sales of illegal drugs for that year alone were somewhere in the vicinity of between $250 and $300 billion, a relative pittance by today's standards. By comparison, however, the entire cost of the U.S. war in Vietnam was less than $230 billion. Americans spent more money buying illegal narcotics in 1 year, every year during the 1980s, than the entire cost of the Vietnam War. The cumulative gross profits of the illegal drug sales from 1978, when we first wrote Dope Incorporated, up until 1990, conservatively add up to $6.25 trillion. That is more than the entire cost to the U.S. government and the U.S. people of the Cold War from 1945 until the fall of the Berlin Wall. This includes the Korean War, the missile race, Vietnam, all of the CIA and Pentagon covert wars, the entire defense and intelligence budget of the post-World War II epoch. But in a certain sense, even these figures are a bit deceptive. They grossly understate the devastating impact of drugs and money laundering on the economy. In the wave of cultural pessimism that swept across America following the assassinations of the 1960s, John F. Kennedy, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, Robert Kennedy, the policymaking establishment in the United States adopted the insane dogma of what was called the post-industrial society. That's quite a politically correct term. It's like calling death post-life. The effect on the American economy of the adoption of the post-industrial society program was more or less the equivalent of death. In a sequence of stunning reforms beginning under Lyndon Johnson, the U.S. financial system was put through the free market post-industrial wringer. Richard Nixon, who, by the way, passed the most generous investment tax credits on to the entertainment industry, in his infamous August 15, 1971, new economic policy, decoupled the dollar from the gold-based system of fixed exchange rates. Nixon, in effect, inaugurated what is today a $1 trillion a day unregulated currency speculation market. Through Kissinger's oil hoax of 1973 to 74, energy costs were artificially inflated. The oil multinationals and their allied banks made a killing in what came to be known as petrodollars and eurodollars, and our farming and manufacturing base took its first really big hit. Next came the deregulation frenzy, beginning in 1978 under the Carter Trilateral Commission administration. Banking deregulation is a Washington Wall Street euphemism for the legalization of drug money laundering, plain and simple. Between 1978 and 1982, all existing regulations that protected banks against invasion by offshore illegal capital were abolished. Dope trafficking may have remained technically illegal in this country, but the flow of dope dollars into the main arteries of the American banking system were totally legalized. Prior to this banking deregulation, money laundering was a fairly labor-intensive business. Organized crime had taken a big chunk of its prohibition-era profits and built up the Nevada gambling industry, the motion picture industry, professional sports, and other high-volume cash businesses to facilitate laundering their dirty money. With the dope offensive of the 1970s, however, this mode of money washing no longer sufficed. Since organized crime, the Lansky Syndicate, the ADL, were always just assets of the international financial oligarchy and their southern jurisdiction, Scottish Rite infrastructure, it was no problem to call on other assets, in the Congress in particular, to turn the world banking system into one big laundromat for dirty cash. The FBI and the Federal Reserve, which along with the ADL were treasonous turn-of-the-century creations of the Teddy Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson crowd, provided critical aid in this narco-dollar offensive. The FBI, through its 1979 abscam frame-up of Senator Harrison Williams, broke the congressional opposition to bank deregulation. Senator Williams was pushing legislation to reestablish international banking ground rules to protect American banks and you, the depositors. Courtesy of Gay Edgar Hoover's FBI, Senator Williams was carted off to federal prison, and the U.S. Congress rolled over and played dead. For the most part, they're still playing dead today. The abscam message from the FBI to the Congress was very simple. Take your money and your marching orders from the ADL, from organized crime, and from the southern jurisdiction, and we'll leave you alone. Take on the banks, and you're as good as dead. The Fed, particularly after Paul Volcker's appointment as chairman in 1979, delivered the second devastating blow to the U.S. banking system by progressively jacking up interest rates to over 20%. What honest businessman could borrow money at 20% to invest in manufacturing expansion, job creation, plant modernization? What farmer, even a farmer who owned his own land outright, could buy seed and fertilizer, replace equipment, or irrigate his or her land at 20% interest rates? What average Joe could take out a home mortgage at those exorbitant, usurious rates? On the other hand, the combined effect of eliminating of the bank transparency laws and the Fed's high interest rate policy turned our banks and saving institutions into safe and lucrative havens for offshore drug money. It's no wonder that when President Reagan briefly toyed with the idea back in the spring of 1981 of dumping Volcker as chairman of the Fed, in large measure at the urging of Lyndon LaRouche and the growing political movement at that time that stood behind the demand to eliminate the power of the Fed, David Rockefeller personally visited the White House and threatened to unleash, quote, a financial firestorm over Washington, unquote, if the president did not back down. By 1982, the U.S. banking system was more addicted to dope dollars than the worst junkie on the street was addicted to heroin or cocaine. The banking system had dried up as a source of credit for honest investors out to create productive jobs in manufacturing or farming. Narco dollars flooded into the U.S. and brought new ruin to what was left of the American economy. Junk bonds became the new preferred mode of financing for the real estate bubble and corporate asset stripping. Junk bonds as in junk that was being peddled on the streets of America to generate the cash for these things. Most of you are familiar with the dramatis personae. Ivan Boesky, Michael Milken, both generous multi-million dollar tax exempt contributors to the ADL. The ADL's own national chairman and top Wall Street lawyer, Kenneth Bialkin, the man who put Robert Vesco and the Medellin cartel in the dope business. all are members of Meyer Lansky's National Crime Syndicate. In the case of Milken and Boesky, they briefly went to jail for their ostensible crime, insider trading. But these fellows were never prosecuted for their real crime, dope money laundering. Michael Milken, who operated out of the Beverly Hills, i.e. Hollywood, branch office of Drexel Burnham Lambert, could access tens of billions of dollars on a moment's notice. By 1984, when Milken was orchestrating Carl Icahn's planned takeover of Phillips Petroleum, he could write what he called, quote, a highly confident letter, simply asserting that he could deliver $4 billion in cash for the corporate takeover and looting. No cash on the barrel, no role whatsoever for any commercial bank, just the word of Michael Milken. Where was the money? The closest thing to an answer that Milken ever gave was offshore. Now, who in their right mind would have even a second thought about what Milken was referring to when he proclaimed his ability to access tens of billions of dollars parked somewhere offshore? The entire economy of virtually every country in the Caribbean couldn't generate $10 billion in liquidity in 20 years' time, and he was talking about accessing tens of billions of dollars offshore. On the strength of those two words, highly confident, and on the narco dollars standing behind them, Milken's raiders cut a path through corporate America that left in its wake plant closings, layoffs, a string of Chapter 11 bankruptcies, the SNL debacle, the blowout of the commercial real estate market, and now the pending unavoidable blowout of the commercial bank sector. It is impossible to comprehend what happened to the physical economy, our financial system, or our culture over the past 25 years without understanding the full meaning of this narco-dollar phenomenon. In the 1980s, this was heralded as the consumer-led recovery. Increase in consumption, however, is not in every instance a good thing. Just ask the snake who's biting his own tail what happens if he increases his consumption too rapidly. That's more or less what happened to the U.S. economy over the last 25 years. Since the assassination of President Kennedy and the introduction on a mass scale of this irrationalist, culturally pessimistic garbage. Fortunately, there is someone on the scene who has had an awful lot of experience fighting against these monsters and has a field commander's sense of how to hit the enemy on his most vulnerable flank. I'm talking about Lyndon LaRouche. Recently, Mr. LaRouche issued a call for the U.S. government to impose a 0.1% tax on all derivative transactions. The derivative markets are all of the unregulated spawns of the bank deregulation and narco-dollar invasions we've been discussing here. It's speculative betting on future values of currencies, stock indexes, you name it. Your grandfather's shirt size 3 years from now. There are even derivative markets betting on future bankruptcy liquidation rates, and that's a real growth industry for you. LaRouche's proposal is very simple. Force speculators to declare all of these derivative transactions and collect this 0.1% tax on the nominal value of the items being bought or swapped. By forcing these transactions into the light of day under penalty of criminal prosecution for failure to report them, it becomes possible to trace the vast majority of the dirty money flows. By imposing this tax, revenues are generated that in no way interfere with legitimate and productive economic activity. It's a tax on the parasites playing with your future using dope dollars. How much are we talking about? On a daily basis, there are about $1 trillion in foreign currency transactions, the majority of which occur on these derivative markets. $300 billion a day in trading goes on in various kinds of bonds. The little tax that LaRouche is talking about could mean additional revenues of over $1 billion a day. You want to wipe out the official federal government deficit of $300 billion in 1 year or less without any new taxes targeted at honest citizens? without any further damage to what remains of our legitimate economy, then let's launch an all-out effort to get this derivative tax implemented, taking the kind of spirit and using the kinds of methods that Mr. LaRouche referred to yesterday in the efforts during the 1982-83 period. That one little act would start the ball rolling for the reestablishment of national banking and the revival of the American system of political economy. It will stop the hemorrhaging. It won't turn back the onslaught of Sodom and Gomorrah, but it will be an indispensable first step towards restoring our nation and the world as a whole to sanity. Even more importantly, it will be a victory for cultural optimism, one in what we must establish as a long string of such necessary victories. Tearing down the Pike statue is another one. Destroying the Southern jurisdiction and the ADL, another. Victories for cultural optimism. And that, more than anything else, is really what is required to save the world today. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Although I have to say I have to take issue with one thing Jeff mentioned, which is the idea of a futures market in grandfather's shirt size 3 years from now. If these policies continue, grandfather will be dead. And that is the subject of our next presentation, which will be delivered by Kathleen Klonetsky, who is the U.S. editor of Executive Intelligence Review. Her topic is the postmodernist social agenda, societal euthanasia, Kevorkian style. Kathleen?
Ideas have consequences, and if good people don't fight evil ideas, if you think that you can make some kind of deal with the devil or give him a sphere of influence in which to operate, eventually you're going to have hell to pay. Those are the key lessons that I think need to be drawn from the presentations that we have just heard. It would be a drastic mistake to think that what the previous speakers have described exists only in the abstract or as interesting historical facts. Exactly the opposite is true. It is because the population of the United States has, by and large, tolerated the existence of Freemasonry, let itself be dominated by Hollywood and other forms of organized Satanism, and accepted the underlying zero-growth premises of the Malthusians that we now find ourselves literally descending into hell. About 15 years ago, something calling itself the Aquarian Conspiracy crawled out of the closet. Helga alluded to this yesterday in her remarks. Essentially a second generation or more overtly New Age version of the Frankfurt School project, the Aquarian Conspiracy represented an intensification of Freemasonry's war to destroy Western civilization. Based primarily at Stanford University's Research Institute, the Aquarian Conspiracy openly declared that its goal was to organize a massive paradigm shift from the age of Pisces, that is Christ, to the age of Dionysus. A crucial part of this paradigm shift was to force through a new image of man that would emphasize his irrational and hedonistic impulses while suppressing his capacity for creative reason, which is the unique characteristic that distinguishes man from animals and allows him to participate in the divine. Unfortunately, the Aquarian Conspiracy has pretty much accomplished its objectives, and what we are living with today are the awful consequences of this paradigm shift. The most fundamental idea of Western civilization, that man is made in the image of God, and that as a result, human life is sacred, has been severely eroded and now stands in danger of disappearing altogether. As a direct result of this, the floodgates are being opened in every area of life to the most extreme forms of barbarism. The mass genocide and mass systematic rapes taking place in Bosnia right now is a horrifying example of the evil that is inevitably unleashed when society discards the concept of the sacredness of life. We are verging on a satanic society. This is not an exaggeration. If you consider that the essence of evil is death and destruction, that the defining characteristic of Satanism is human sacrifice, then you have only to look at what has become of American society over the last two decades to realize just how close we have come to becoming an outright satanic entity. Look at the situation in the U.S. right now. Look at their schools. We now have a situation where children as young as the first grade are being taught in the classroom that homosexuality and other perversions are a legitimate alternative lifestyle. And although parents and church groups in New York City were recently able to oust the school's chancellor there, Joseph Fernandez, who was a champion of this atrocity called the Rainbow Curriculum, which was a so-called multicultural program that features such books as Heather Has Two Mommies, similar courses are being promoted in schools throughout the country. Through so-called values education, such as the ADL's World of Difference program, children are being brainwashed into believing that the world has too few resources and too many people, and that the only solution to this dilemma is to knock off some of this excess human population. At Stanford University, which was the birthplace of the Aquarian conspiracy, the long-standing Western civilization course requirement was eliminated several years ago on the grounds that Shakespeare, Leibniz, and the other dead white European males who contributed so much to the development of Western culture were too imperialistic or patriarchal. Now, under the banner of political correctness, students at Stanford participate in a cultures, ideas, and values program, which features such courses as population perspectives in the third world and critical perspectives on feminist theory. This evil cult of political correctness is rampaging through colleges and universities throughout the country, destroying anyone who has the temerity to stand up and defend Western values. This is ritual child abuse, plain and simple. We are allowing our children to be turned into illiterate, irrational beasts, incapable of coherent thought, and certainly incapable of running a country. This is how you soften up people for Satanism. We find an even more graphic demonstration of this demonic paradigm shift in the inroads which the so-called Right to Die movement has made over the past decade. Again, because the American population has compromised with the death lobby, going along with living wills, pulling the plug on coma patients, allowing abortion on demand, that we have wound up with a phenomenon like that Dr. Jack Kevorkian, a psychotic mass murderer who is running around the country killing people in cold blood. Not only is he getting away with this, but Kevorkian is being held up as a hero by some quarters. Now, evidence has now come to light that one of Kevorkian's most recent victims, Mr. Hugh Gantz, changed his mind at the last minute and told Dr. Death that he didn't want to die. Kevorkian went right ahead and pumped the poor man full of carbon monoxide until he was dead. Now, that is the essence of the Death with Dignity movement, getting murdered in your sickbed by a doctor who has supposedly taken a sacred oath to heal you. Kevorkian's murder spree underscores what a hoax the whole Right to Die movement is. It's nothing but a movement designed to cut costs by killing off what the Nazi euthanasia program, on which it is explicitly modeled, called useless eaters. What Kevorkian's victims and the victims of the Death with Dignity movement as a whole are discovering, unfortunately too late, is that you have a right to die in this country, but you no longer have a right to live. The U.S. is moving rapidly toward adopting a policy of active euthanasia. We are moving dangerously close to the situation that already exists in Holland, where under a state-imposed assisted suicide program, thousands of people are put to death each year, like dogs, without their consent, because they are considered to be too great a burden on society. And in a very ominous development just a few days ago, President Clinton announced that he was giving the green light to a plan developed by the state of Oregon to implement health care rationing for Medicaid recipients. The plan, which even the Bush administration had blocked because of widespread protests by advocates for the disabled and the poor, is a Nazi policy, plain and simple. As Linda Everett has documented in New Federalist, the Oregon plan is primarily a triage program, not a health care program. It is designed to control medical costs by prohibiting treatment for certain categories of patients and illnesses. Under the plan, if you fall in one of the useless eaters categories, for instance, if you suffer from certain chronic disabilities, have been classified as terminally ill, even though this is a very unscientific and elastic definition, or are otherwise deemed to lack sufficient quality of life, you will be denied access to certain medical procedures, even though you may die without them. Unfortunately, Unfortunately, there are signs that the Clinton administration may actually use Oregon's Nazi plan as a model for its national health reform program, which would be a disastrous turn of events. We must understand that unless we force Clinton to adopt Lyndon LaRouche's economic policies, that the spiraling economic collapse will lead inexorably to the adoption of these and similar fascist programs. Now, Kevorkian and the Oregon rationing plan are just parts of a wide-ranging aggressive assault on human life whose success can be directly attributed to the deliberate and systematic destruction of Western values, which the other speakers have discussed. Since the late 1970s, when the Right to Die movement began to get off the ground in earnest, it has become increasingly clear that the policymaking elite in the United States has made a decision to deal with the economic crisis which it created through its own greed and stupidity, not by adopting growth-producing economic policies, but by slating whole sections of the population for extermination. The poor, the unemployed, the mentally ill are now all considered useless eaters. You need only go to any city in the country and see the millions of people who are forced to live on the streets in the most squalid conditions, unable to get shelter, food, or medical care, to realize how true this is. Now, America's elderly, as a group, are slated to be one of the major groups who will be sacrificed by the financial oligarchy to its god of usury. Richard Lamb, the former Democratic governor of Colorado, may have shocked many people back in 1984 when he said that the elderly have a duty to die and get out of the way of the younger generation. But he was only enunciating publicly what had by then become the behind-the-scenes consensus of U.S. policymaking circles. Now, over the past few years, there has been an endless flood of Lamb-style propaganda, claiming that the U.S. spends far too much on the elderly through entitlement programs — that's the official term given to Social Security and Medicare — and insisting that if we don't start putting the squeeze on those over 65, there won't be enough resources for the young. The population is being inundated with the message that killing off grandma is the politically correct thing to do. If resources are limited, the argument goes, it's better to put granny on an ice floe than it is to let junior starve. If little Johnny is to have a decent life, then grandpa must give up his. In 1987, Daniel Callahan, who is a leading bioethicist and director of the influential Hastings Center, wrote a book called Setting Limits, which should give you a sense of the mentality driving this attack on the elderly. Callahan maintained that there is a natural lifespan of approximately 75 years, which is complete nonsense, and said that the government should not spend one penny on any life-extending medical treatment for people over that age. To do so, he said, would both violate nature and, far more important, would be too expensive for society. If the young are to flourish, Callahan wrote, then the old should step aside in an active way. The acceptance of their aging and death would be a principal stimulus to do this. Government, he went on, and I'm quoting Callahan now, cannot be expected to bear without restraint the growing social and economic cost of health care for the elderly. It must draw lines. Our common social obligation to the elderly, he said, is only to help them live out a natural lifespan. That is, the government is obliged to provide deliberately life-extending health care only to the age which is necessary to achieve that goal, which in Callahan's view is about 75. He then went on to say that he believes that an age-based standard for the termination of life-extending treatment would be legitimate, and that the meaning and significance of life for the elderly themselves is best founded on a sense of limits to health care. That same year, Peter Peterson, who's a very prominent Wall Street banker and currently the chairman of the board of the New York Council on Foreign Relations, published a book called On Borrowed Time, which advanced many of the same arguments as Callahan. Peterson, whose former business partner, Roger Altman, now serves in the number two post at the U.S. Treasury Department, has since gone on to play a pivotal role in shaping the debate over the fate of the nation's elderly. In particular, Peterson has attempted to pit the young against the old, lying that there are limited resources, and insisting that the only way for the young to survive is by limiting the elderly's consumption. In a speech to the American Assembly in 1991, Peterson blamed what he called vast entitlement programs for the elderly for the ballooning growth in the U.S. budget deficit. He claimed that U.S. national interest is, quote, best served by programs that direct public resources toward investment and youth, not toward consumption and age. And he said further that to ensure that the right redirection of resources is made, the U.S. should move toward progressive taxation of Social Security benefits, which the Clinton administration has recently proposed, and adopt other measures which would have the direct effect of driving up the death rate among those over 65. To a large degree, the 1992 presidential election campaign was structured to set the stage for the implementation of some form of the program that Callahan and Peterson advocate. Several of the candidates, most notably Ross Perot and Paul Tsongas, played especially important roles in this regard, emphasizing repeatedly the supposed need to slash Social Security and Medicare in order to free up resources for investment in the young. To bolster these contentions, a number of leading establishment think tanks issued guidelines for the incoming administration recommending the same lethal policies. One of the most chilling of these was a report published last fall by the Center for Strategic and International Studies here in Washington, which argued for massive cuts in the federal budget, especially in Medicare and Medicaid. The report complained that approximately 30% of total Medicare dollars are spent on patients in the last year of their lives, and warned that comprehensive health care reform will not be complete without a social consensus on care for the terminally ill. Translated into pure English, this means that the elderly and terminally ill must be hurried to their graves for the sake of deficit reduction. Now, this Nazi-style campaign against the elderly has accelerated tremendously in the last 6 months. President Clinton's budget not only calls for huge cuts in Medicare, it also increases the tax on Social Security benefits for retirees with an income of $25,000 a year or more. Now, that is hardly a princely sum, especially for an elderly person who frequently spends hundreds of dollars a month on prescriptions alone. During the same period, our good friend Peter Peterson has personally established several supposedly grassroots groups to lobby for deep reductions in Social Security and Medicare as part of an across-the-board austerity program for the U.S. One of these groups is the Concord Coalition, which Peterson co-founded along with Paul Tsongas, former Senator Warren Rudman, and Washington insider attorney Lloyd Cutler. Not only have all these individuals been instrumental in promoting the very economic policies that drove the United States into its current collapse, they have also been in the vanguard of the campaign to reduce Americans' living standards to prop up their bankrupt financial system. Last year, for example, Warren Rudman called for a one-party dictatorship in the United States on the grounds that this would be the most efficient way to implement austerity. And Lloyd Cutler, who was White House counsel to Jimmy Carter, advocates eliminating the U.S. constitutional system for precisely the same reason. Now, the Concord Coalition is bad enough, but far more insidious is another of Peterson's so-called grassroots groups, Lead or Leave. This is a group of bloodthirsty yuppie punks which Peterson, Ross Perot, Lee Iacocca, Coca, and some other money bags set up last summer for the express purpose of fomenting what they call a generational war of the young against the old. And you know who's on the board of Lead or Leave? Well, Richard Lamb, of course, as well as Massachusetts Governor William Weld, the dope lobby asset who helped orchestrate the judicial lynching of Lyndon LaRouche and his associates and is now being touted as a Republican presidential candidate in the next elections. Now, it's quite clear from Leader Lee's propaganda that they are consciously intended to replicate the Hitler Youth Movement, which campaigned relentlessly for the extermination of Germany's elderly and mentally and physically handicapped. Lead or Leave is going to the very colleges and universities which, like Stanford, are teaching students that it is politically incorrect to hold human life sacred, and telling these same students that their futures depend on stopping their greedy and no longer productive parents and grandparents from hogging resources. Lead or Leave is trying to enlist young people who have already been softened up by years of miseducation into a shock troop against the new enemy, their own mothers and fathers. The two main frontmen for this neo-Nazi operation are Rob Nelson and John Cowan. And I don't think it will come as much of a surprise to learn that Cowan used to work for Mel Levine, one of the ADL's biggest boosters in Congress, or that his father is active in the California ADL, which is yet more proof of the fascist nature of the Anti-Defamation League. At the behest of Peterson and their other Wall Street backers, Nelson and Cowan are trying to whip up a lynch mob against those over 65 using the most demagogic methods imaginable. Last month, Ted Koppel's Nightline devoted a whole program to these murderous creatures, where they ranted that Social Security is an unfair and unsound program and a generational scam. They charged that the younger generation is getting ripped off and said that Leader Leaves' war against the elderly is this younger generation's Vietnam. The establishment media has been giving the group a tremendous amount of publicity over the last few months. In addition to Nightline, they've been written up in the Boston Globe, the New York Times, the Washington Post, and other establishment papers, and were featured recently on the cover of U.S. News and World Report. In an op-ed they wrote for the New York Times in February, Nelson and Cowan called for reducing Social Security cost of living increases and raising the retirement age from 65 to at least 70, among other measures. Older voters and politicians be warned, they said. Younger Americans aren't going to let you continue destroying our country. Well, our country is being destroyed by the prevalence of the kind of satanic mentality exhibited by Lead or Leave. Lead or Leave could not have existed 30 years ago, and they certainly could never have gotten away with their vicious propaganda. They are the children of the Aquarian conspiracy's paradigm shift. They are the result of America's failure to defend Western civilization against the concerted battle waged against it. And their existence should serve as fair warning that we must mobilize our forces to defeat Satan and his Freemasonic minions, first and foremost by getting Lyndon LaRouche out of jail. We do have the capacity to do this. It is possible. But if we don't fight, the United States will become a hell on earth. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathleen. We now have approximately 40 minutes for questions and discussion. As people are lining up with the microphones or considering what questions or comments they would like to make, I have one announcement, which is the following. All Muslims, please come to the Hunter Room at 12:30 for prayer. And as people are considering questions and comments, I would like to use this opportunity also to have the messages of greetings read that we have received from Michael Billington and Rochelle Asher. I would like to ask John Asher to come forward. I would also like to ask Margaret Greenspan to come forward. Gail Billington is right now visiting Mike in jail, so she will not be able to read the message, but Mike's sister, Margaret, will read it. And as they are coming forward to read those messages, I would like to do one other thing and make a simple point, which is that one of the essential purposes of the legal terror and barbarism and assaults against our organization, besides putting LaRouche in jail, which has been of fundamental importance to our enemy, to try to destroy him, get him out of the way, that another one of the purposes of this operation obviously has been to dismantle us as an institution. The institution, the organization, the movement, the international movement, which LaRouche is chiefly responsible for creating. And among those weapons that have been used in this effort has been an attempt to terrorize the members of this movement with exemplary barbaric treatment of those who have faced trials and have been convicted. Perhaps the most shocking and scandalous is that of Mike Billington's with his 77-year sentence, which he is currently serving. It is by no means the only one. In fact, it's so far from the only one that I want to use the occasion. This is might risk a mass movement here, but I would like to ask all of those who were indicted in the New York cases, the Alexandria case, and the Virginia cases to please stand up. I was going to have you come forward, but that's going to take too much time. But if you could stand up, I think it's actually very interesting for everyone to see how many of us there are. And I think it's safe to say that I speak for all of us when I say that we are proud of our convictions. So, Margaret?
This is from Michael Billington, who's at the Nottoway Correctional Center in Burkeville, Virginia. As I write this message to you all from the Virginia prison system, a young man is being electrocuted in a nearby Virginia penitentiary after the judicial system, from Mary Sue Terry to the Supreme Court of the United States, refused even to honor his plea for a hearing to determine whether or not frying a man slowly to death constitutes cruel and unusual punishment under the U.S. Constitution. This serves as yet another gruesome piece of evidence that the Constitution of this nation no longer governs the actions or the decision-making processes of our governing bodies. If we are to succeed in changing that, then we must change the American people to make them see in mankind and in themselves more than the unrestrained passions and greed which dominate popular culture today. If people cannot locate in themselves the reflection of the creative power of the universe, then how can they find the compassion necessary to stand up against the worldwide atrocities of our new dark age? To help mankind find that living image of God in themselves is to think like St. Augustine, like Cusa, like Leibniz, or like Lyndon LaRouche. These past 6 months in the Virginia Gulag have been spent with a Chinese scholar and statesman from the 12th century, Chu Si, who led a Confucian Renaissance that saved China from a Taoist dark age. I shared the joy that Leibniz once felt in his own discovery of this great man's work 300 years ago. That Chu Si, in fact, did think like Cusa, further confirming Leibniz's faith in the unity of God's creation. What is proven is that every human child has a capacity to be a sage, to live in the imitation of Christ, or as Confucius said, to face the Lord of heaven all day. This is true both because each child is blessed with a divine spark of reason, which gives him or her the equal potential to participate in the unfolding creation, but also because each child from any culture that has survived up to this time, can find somewhere in the roots of that culture the reflection of the vision of man as being in the image of God, as was most beautifully expressed in the Christian Renaissance in Europe. Of course, that child can also find in that culture, any culture, the reflection of the opposite view of man, like that which brought us the rock, drug, sex counterculture of today and the Scottish Rite of Albert Pike. What is required is leaders who know the difference. So if each of you will decide to become a sage, then we can get Lynn out of prison, along with a few other fellows and ladies, and we can get down to business. So I hope to see you soon.
Recently, I was reading from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. when he said to his supporters, quote, "Remember, sometimes it has to get awfully dark before you see the stars." Well, when the supreme sovereign of the Scottish Rite feels forced in his own name to attack Lynn as the most important enemy of the Freemasons of the world, I think that not only will the stars begin to shine, but more likely something on the scale of the explosion of the asteroid belt is about to occur. Please know that even though I wish I were there physically, I am there in spirit, fighting every minute of every day. While I'll leave the preaching to Reverend Bevel, I want to leave you with a quote from Matthew. "For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" I know how hard we have all been fighting, But in that spirit, may we vow to fight even harder to get Lynn out now, especially for the children of Bosnia and the millions of children suffering all over the world. With love, Rochelle Asher, Virginia Correctional Center for Women, Goochland, Virginia. Thank you.
Reverend Bevel's got some competition. And I think it's fairly clear that from the two statements that have been read, no matter what the efforts of the enemy to destroy and demoralize and frighten our membership, with the kind of leadership in courage and leadership intellectually that Mike and Shelley are helping to provide, there is no question but that we will not be defeated. And we thank them for that. We can begin with the first question.
Okay, my name is Jim Cleary from New Jersey. I have to explain a little bit before I ask the question. My brother just recently has become involved with something that, from what he has explained, sounds to me is a cultish type of thing in New York City and Manhattan. They call themselves the New School, and it has a philosophy branch and it has a economics branch. And from what he described of it to me, it's almost like where the individuals involved are brainwashing themselves. But just recently, he said that it's a branch of the London School of Economics. So I'm just wondering if anybody in their research has come across either of these two operations.
Is anyone going to admit to know anything about this? I have to admit that I went to grad school there for one day. One day. What was it?
Okay. Never heard of it. The one thing that differentiates the New School, of course, is that the New School was set up, modeled on, in part, the London School of Economics, and it was set up by a group of emigre scholars from, starting in 1933, after Hitler came to power, which meant that a lot of the people who were involved in the creation of the New School and its departments were literally the Frankfurt School and their close collaborators and, you know, Southwest German neo-Kantians and all manner of really crazy people. I think it's important to stress, however, that there is no, this is everywhere. What we've been describing in some of the work on political correctness that you've read in Fidelio and New Federalist, and we'll hear tomorrow at the Deconstruction panel, I think it's important to realize that although we can highlight places like the New School and Stanford University and places like that, that this stuff is everywhere and its spore goes down to the grade schools, which is why you're talking about having to create a renaissance to counteract it. You cannot take these things on a molecular basis. The New School is a very bad place. Most higher education institutions that you can go to today or send your children to and spend a lot of money sending them there are comparable.
Yes, next.
My name is Gene Roberts. I'm from Detroit, Michigan, the home of Jack Kevorkian. Supposedly, a poll was taken in Michigan. 55% of the Michiganians are in favor of what Jack Kevorkian's doing. But on a bigger plane that I've never heard addressed directly in all my years of coming to conferences is the fact that one of the biggest groups of social pessimists is the variations of the Baptist, Southern Baptist, and other so-called fundamental Christian groups that teach that we're in the last days. And then you ask them, well, how do you know we're in the last days? And they say, because things in the last days are supposed to get worse and worse, and that's what's happening. And then you say, well, why are things supposed to get worse and worse? And they say, well, because we're in the last days. It's a circular reasoning. And I wonder, in our organizing, how can we address this kind of horrendous social pessimism? It is the largest evangelical denomination in the United States.
Jimmy Carter has left the Southern Baptists because they are being taken over by us. This was in the Scottish Rite Journal. They are in a pandemonium. That means when hell is too noisy for themselves to think. There is every evidence that the enemy is fixated on this statue and related developments like the fight going on in the Baptists in a kind of mental paralysis. But what we should say here is that this age now that we're in is not only a dark age, but it is also the beginning of the Renaissance. We are in the beginning of the Renaissance. Right? Now you can, when you see the strategy of tension being carried out by the P2 and by various condominiums against Germany and the wars and the terrorism at the World Trade Center, this is a strategy of insanity, of distraction. Reason has its own action, its own agenda. It's not only a program for developing Europe, Lynn's program, but the continual intervention of our program and of our interventions against the enemy has its own shaping of this age, which will be seen later to be the beginning of the Renaissance. Lynn talked about his interventions with the SDI, with Operation Juarez, and with the Triangle Program, leading to a tremendous spread of our influence and of our organization in Europe and in South America and in the United States, and leading to tremendous consequences that have already taken place in the world. Our counterattack, for example, even at Stanford University, we go in there and we immediately turn the place around. Where Reverend Bevel's statement on this is totally key. The earth is the Lord's. It doesn't belong to Satan at all. And wherever we go, we immediately transform the situation with our organizing. We did this with the New Left back in when we had only a few people back in the 1960s, where the government was, or the Ford Foundation, so forth, were setting up environmentalism and the New Left. We retarded environmentalism by a number of years by attacking the thing at its birth, and we killed off the New Left, and they've been retarded ever since. That's right. I want to mention, though, in continuing this attack, where we might be going in the future. For example, the Scottish Rite Masons have another front that they operate on, which is child care, and particularly the care of mentally disturbed and otherwise handicapped children, and also the care of schizophrenics. You should note that the center of the neo-Nazi movement, which has a lot to do with these Scottish Rite Masons, it has two centers. One of them is Nebraska, and the other is San Francisco. These are the two centers of world neo-Nazism. When you begin to attack this phenomena of somebody carrying out a crime or a series of crimes that so directly affect the family, the thousands or hundreds of thousands of children disappearing, it's obvious to everybody that this is going to be a powerful attack on our part, and that the Masons are really in trouble. Just to give you two examples of this, we recently found out that the International Order of the Job's Daughters which is the teenage girls section of Freemasonry, is headquartered in Omaha, Nebraska. The AZA, the International Teenage Boys section of B'nai B'rith, is also headquartered in Omaha, Nebraska. Father Flanagan's Boys Town was set up by those people, that is the Masons and the B'nai B'rith. And if you, you read the Franklin story from Nebraska about ritual abuse and Satanism, you see what is something that we have the power to take down in a completely nonlinear way. So in talking to the people about the last days, it's clear to many people in the Baptists that this we are in the last days of the Masons.
Yes, next question.
Yeah, this is for I'm Tony Hadley from Philadelphia. This is for Mike Minichino. On the issue of the television itself, on how it operates, because I've noticed even when giving videos of Lynn, where people were very interested in the content of what he's saying, even when the video is over, I still kind of see sort of a stare or a glaze in people's eyes, you know, that there's something in the television itself. And I believe that the television could have been used for good or should be used for good. But I was wondering, have you done any research on how the actual TV functions? I believe it actually flashes 60 cycles or 60 times a second or something like that. But I was wondering if you have done any research on the actual functioning of the TV itself or the picture.
I thought Kissinger was the only one who flashed 60 times a second.
There's a lot of work which has been done. It is well known that television will reduce your brainwave patterns. It's absolutely given. Any form of television, once you get into it, your brainwave patterns, which just start to go down, which means you are entertained. You're entertained by television. Television is, it's very important you bring it up with Lynn. That's a necessary evil, insofar as there are necessary evils. If Lynn were able to freely had a lot, were out of prison and had lots of money to freely go all over the place, we probably would de-emphasize television. The things that television is not an art form. Television is not art. It has no pretension to art. I mean, a lot of people say it has art. Films, you can't reduce art in a two-dimensional medium that moves and where the director is telling you the focus, the positioning, the perspective, and everything else. There's no, it's the whole medium is designed to reduce your engagement with the concepts that are involved. And yes, you're absolutely right. Putting Lyndon LaRouche on television is something I really hate doing. and I'm the guy who's responsible for it. And the more I use graphics and stuff like that, that's more entertaining to you and easier for you to understand as opposed to seeing Lynn for, like we used to do in 84, where you just would talk for 25 minutes. The more that makes it more accessible to more people and the more it fulfills the true role of television, the more it is in fact reducing your brain power as you're watching it. So that is absolutely the case. If you want more information on that, it definitely does. I can give it to you privately, but there is definitely a lot of clinical studies which have been done that prove conclusively that this stuff, even on a technical basis, makes you stupid.
Yes, next.
I'm going to ask a question after I make a quick statement. In response to what Shelley Asher said through John, when I was a student at Howard University about a year ago, I came to the Baltimore local and didn't know who Shelley was and sat down with her, and I thought I was really radical black militant. And I wasn't supposed to like white ladies or anything, right? And then Shelley, everyone knows, is physically beautiful. She's a beautiful lady. And then she was about exponentially more radical and militant than I was. And I said, something's wrong here. It totally threw me off. The point I'm making is that she really touched my soul that day. And she was going to jail in a couple of days. And it transformed me. And go back to something that Dr. Aleem said at Morgan State. He said about Reverend Bevel, he said, you couldn't pay this man back for all that he's done for you. And that's the thing, like with Shelley, when she touched my soul that day, it's like, you can't really pay people back for that. The only appropriate response to that is to give your life to the idea or to the process that they're fighting for. Now I want to turn this into a confession, a church. I haven't been doing as much as I could be doing, I know, to free Lynn. But I'm going to tell you, it's like what Reverend Bevel said. He's giving cutting-edge, state-of-the-art theological science, this lecture last night. There are no evil people. The only reason that I didn't fight as hard as I could to free Lynn is because I didn't really understand who Lynn really is. And attending this conference, it has totally reshaped the geometry of my thinking. Talking with Phil Valenti about the farm situation, on how this connects with, you know, the whole world picture. And then hearing Mike give this really in-depth analysis of the political correctness and what that all means. And then hearing Mr. Steinberg talk about the drugs. And this gives me an idea of who Lynn is, because he's producing people who are effective fighters. Now, and the only way to solve these problems is to be that efficient, based on this principle of potential relative population density, that scientific breakthroughs, like Reverend Bevel says, which are just as exact in the sociological world as they are in the physical world, that Lynn makes in terms of politics, economics, increases the ability of the world to grow, of the population. And so I'm saying that since I understand this, now I heard you guys, the way you built the organizations, you old guys up there used to be pretty radical and rambunctious. And I'm saying, like, as a young guy, I know what my responsibility is. And the point is this, is that, look, you know, and in truth, actually everything has to shut down until Lynn goes free. Everything. I don't care what the hell you are doing in your life. All you people who are here visiting from schools, it's obvious that the people here, the wisdom that we're getting here is, it doesn't even compare. It's a different species of the academic crap that we get fed in schools. So the point is, you know, why would you go back and lick up your vomit after today? Join the movement full time. We need to shut down every campus. And the same thing for everyone who has a job. I mean, what are you trying to get? What are you trying to get? You need money? Join the phone team. Raise some money. Okay, that's basically what I wanted to say. No.
No question. This man has talked to Shelley Asher.
My quick question is to Mike. I just wanted to know what you meant by there are no polls.
Let me just answer your first comment. The way we built this organization, in the very, very beginning, as you said, there were some unnamed radicals who I never knew myself, personally. And what they would do is, using the same kind of concepts that Lynn outlines in On the Subject of Metaphor, they would choose ironic points on college campuses, issues that were just exploitable enough to get a bit of a fight going so that we could invite Linda LaRouche on campus. And Lynn would talk about the meaning of life. And that's how we recruited a whole bunch of people. And that's the way you're going to recruit a whole bunch of people is today. You're going to create issues on the campus, and then you're going to invite Lynn on campus. And he's going to talk about the meaning of life. And until we can get him out there physically, I ask you to all perform the act of consubstantiation or transubstantiation, however you want to call it, that you have to recreate Lynn on the campus, not talking about a specific issue, but about the meaning of life, which is what Lynn used to do when we recruit people, because that's what college students, if they've got a brain left in their head, want to know about. Now, on the question of polls, total fraud. If you listen to a poll, you believe a poll, you deserve everything you get. I actually did something that was very obvious. I read the textbooks, and I know how it's done. Take this room, divide it, bring people at random to fill up the seats in the entire place. Divide it in two right here, okay? You have the right side of the room, you have the left side of the room. This is the actual textbook case with the actual figures. Each side of the room gets a questionnaire. Two different questionnaires. Two questions on the questionnaires. The second question is the same. On the right side of the room, the second question, and on the left side of the room, the second question reads, a woman, a married woman, who would like to limit the size of her family should be allowed to have an abortion. There is nothing up my sleeve. This side of the room, the right side of the room, 55% will answer no. This side of the room, 55% will answer yes. How do you do it? First question. On this side of the room, which is the so-called pro-life side, the first question reads, who do you think will win the American League pennant? Some neutral question. Okay? This side of the room, the first question reads, a woman who had, no, excuse me, I've got that backwards. This is the pro-life group. Your first question reads, a woman who discovers that her child will be severely retarded should be allowed to have an abortion. People will answer 55% yes to that. But having answered 55% yes on the question of severe retardation, we'll see that abortion for the purposes of family limitation is trivial, and therefore we'll vote against it. And that's how you will, but you will only know the second question. You just manipulated by the various questions. I can produce a 5 to 10% differentiation by saying the government should allow versus the government should forbid. That will automatically produce 5 to 10% differentiation. Everybody votes against the government shall forbid. I can produce a 3 to 5% variation by using the word welfare versus public assistance. This is an art form, and the people who do it are artists, and that's what they're paid big money to do.
We will not take a poll on when we are going to have a lunch break. It will happen in approximately 10 minutes. So let's proceed with questions and answers as rapidly as possible.
Dave Starks, Philadelphia. I have two quick questions. One, with the man that was doing the thing on money laundering. I just wondered if you could elaborate more on the connection with sports. And also for Mr. Chaykin, I was wondering if you, you know, since we had protested the Albert Pike statue, is there any protest in the works, or what do you feel about the issue concerning the Confederate flag for the southern states?
I'll answer by a fairly simple example. You're a drug runner, and you've got millions and millions of dollars in cash being built up in suitcases, in warehouses, wherever, and you want to find some effective way to use it. Best thing to have available to you are large places where tens and at sometimes hundreds of thousands of people all go and pay 5 or 10 or 20, and I probably assume now $50 or $100 per person to get in the door to attend some professional football game or something like that, drop another $20 or $30 maybe per person, slugging down beer and eating hot dogs and things like that, and there is not an IRS agent hanging out there in the cashier's booth looking at how much money has come into the till by the so-called legitimate entertainment aspect of what's gone on there. And so it was created very much with the idea of not only the cultural subversion, but of creating a untraceable facility through which the easiest thing in the world is to slip a few extra $100,000 or a few $1 million into the combined cash take. And then the secret, and one of the reasons why this old-fashioned method of money laundering was so distasteful, somewhere along the way, you might have to declare that income as part of the income of the stadium or the gambling casino, and you might have to pay taxes on it. So in that sense, it was not only a relatively small scale and inefficient way of laundering the kinds of billions and now trillions of dollars in illegal money that we want to cycle through the economy. It was also something that involved, on at least a small scale, the very distasteful thing of having to part with some of that money by kicking it over to Uncle Sam. Now, take a look at the U.S. economy today. Take a look at sports figures. You've got professional gladiators, basically, earning salaries of $1, $2, maybe $3 million a clip. And this is really chump change, more an inducement and a seduction to get a lot of other people thinking that the way to succeed in life is to become pumped up with steroids and become a jock, rather than do something with your brain and be a human being in the full sense of the word that Reverend Beverly Lynn have talked about it over the last 2 days. So you've got a proliferation of this stuff all over the economy. You used to have, what, 8 professional baseball teams. Now you've got, I don't know, 20 or 30 of them. This is the growth industry. This is the direction the economy is going. Now, that's not to say that physical strenuous exercise is bad. Going back to the time of the Platonic Academy in Athens, it was recognized that strenuous physical exercise, physical training, is of importance to human beings. You ought to be healthy. But sports used to be thought of from the standpoint of man demonstrating his superiority over nature, taking on a challenging task and accomplishing it. There's a race that took place last week in Alaska, which I think I've thought about a little bit. It's an interesting example. It's called the Iditarod. I was up there a while back and I read some things about it. It was set up in 1957 because there was a big storm in Nome, Alaska, and there was an outbreak of some disease and there was no medicine and there was no way to get into that town. And what happened was that the medicine was available in Anchorage, so somebody hitched up a dog sled team and trekked 1,200 miles to carry the medicine to Nome, Alaska in order to save the people there. And it was a combined effort by a human being, a skilled athlete, very skilled, and a team of trained dogs, and they accomplished something that was a life-saving accomplishment. That challenge to defeat nature and do something for human life is the example of what sportsmanship really was in the traditional Republican sense. Hold that up against the image of Hollywood, sports, the television entertainment industry, legalized gambling. There is now a casino in Las Vegas called the Excalibur, which is designed on a Freemasonic theme of King Arthur's court and the Knights of the Round Table. And talk about professional sports. In the middle of the gambling casino hall, which is about 3 acres in one area, you have a dirt ring in which 3 times a day, while the gambling is going on, there are jousting matches, and they've got everything but the lions and Christians there in the middle of the auditorium. So hold up those two images as fairly good examples of what the difference is between gangsterism encouraging bestiality versus something that is by way of physical exercise demonstrating concretely man's superiority over all other forms of nature.
On the Confederate flag, we are ecumenical, and we've really undercut the Confederate concept by turning it around away from a geographical problem. They're members of the Ku Klux Klan or supporters of the Ku Klux Klan who are perfectly good people and who think that they're fighting against, you know, they're rebelling against Washington. the Confederate flag itself is the Scotch cross from the British flag, right? With some Southern stars on the thing, right? The stars and bars. But the point is that this is not a Southern phenomenon. Despite all the culture of the South over decades from slavery, for example, in Mark Calney's work, he talked about Breckinridge at the end of the war conducting the father of D.W. Griffith, I guess it was, to begin his career. Breckinridge was one of these Scottish Rite founders of the secession movement. This is a little clique of people based on British Freemasonry. So what we want to do here is to focus on flipping this entire debate, which we are doing very, very dramatically. We should have, just like we've started in the, and people who think like we started in the Baptist, we should have among the Jewish synagogues over the next, I would say, 3 to 6 months, a furious debate going on about the ADL. So this is the kind of flip on these supposed categories of humanity, North and South, white and black, that we have to put the monkey wrench in and completely destroy. Thank you.
Okay, next. We will take these last four questions, and that's it. So proceed.
Hi, my name is Kelvin Lahr from University of Buffalo, pre-law student, pre-law major and political science major. And I've got a question for Mr. Steinberg and I believe Mrs. Kalinske. I've been told that Bank of Credit Commerce International specifically targeted inner cities for drugs. And I wanted to know if you had any knowledge of that, that Clark Clifford and his colleagues specifically targeted the inner cities. And also for Eileen, I believe, could you elaborate? What do you mean by the miseducation of young people? And my last question is, I'm head of the political science club at University of Buffalo, and students and I have been trying to get involved with this movement, and there's no literature on the Buffalo chapter, and I was wondering why is that? There's no phone numbers, there's no contacts, and could you help us out a little bit?
Are you volunteering? Okay, there we go. We got our Buffalo chapter. Kathleen?
Well, on miseducation, I think a good example is this rainbow curriculum that I talked about earlier, which was developed for grades as early as the first grade. And what it is supposedly this multicultural program. It teaches that everything goes, there's nothing right, there's nothing wrong. It prevents children from developing any sense of values or any sense of morality. As I mentioned, one of the books in it is Heather Has Two Mommies, and there are a bunch of other similar titles, you know, George Has Two Daddies and stuff like this. In the debate that went on in New York City over this rainbow curriculum, I mean, parents got up and said, look, you know, you're teaching our kids how to put on condoms, but you're not teaching them calculus or anything that is required for them to actually function at a human level. If you look at the political, at Stanford, for example, I mean, in the Executive Intelligence Review, we did a recent cover story in which Bob Ingram goes through some of the curricula changes that have taken place at Stanford since 1988, and they're really horrendous. I mean, you can't create a human society if you tell people that there are limits to resources, if this is the basis of your outlook, this is the basis of your training of children. Because what you're telling them is that there is a limit to the human mind, that the human mind and human creativity are finite. Well, that means that you're dooming society. Yet this is the basis of the educational system in the United States over the last 20 or 30 years. We've written a number of, issued a number of reports and other things which you might find useful. One of them we put out 5 or 6 years ago on the libertarian conspiracy, which goes into much greater depth on some of these topics, and I think you'd find that useful.
Let me just say something real quickly about the other part of your question in terms of BCCI. It may be the case that BCCI was involved in that kind of activity. I certainly wouldn't put it past them. They own many, many banks inside the U.S., and it could be the case. But I think the more important point to realize is that people should have gotten suspicious when the cover story in Time magazine exposed the bank for financing drug money laundering and terrorism. Time magazine called it an Arab bank, and the implication, even before this most recent round of propaganda against Islam, was that somehow or other you had a bunch of sleazy sheikhs from the Middle East who were coming into the United States and robbing this country blind. Well, do a little bit of background research and you find out that BCCI was owned by the Rothschild family. You haven't read about that in Time magazine or in the pages of the Wall Street Journal very much. So I would just say, number one, that the BCCI case in and of itself was somewhat blown out of proportion to create the completely fraudulent idea that there's good banks and bad banks. And good banks are the ones that should be saved, and bad banks like BCCI, associated with dirty oil Arab sheikhs, should be shut down, and somehow or other we're dealing with the problem. There's not a clean bank in the United States. There's not an inner city in the United States where virtually every street corner bank is not in one way or other helping out on the destruction of those areas through drugs. So it's a far more basic and fundamental issue on the table here. Our entire banking system, through the process I discussed earlier this morning, has been decimated, and we must start from scratch to put it back together from square one, to reestablish national banking, to create a new generation, I shudder at the thought, of honest accountants who can at least go in and do at least the initial auditing to figure out just how much money was stolen before they go out and get productive jobs. So it's the banking system as a whole that must be torn down and restructured, starting with the Fed, back to national banking and American system economics, and nothing short of that is going to solve any of the kinds of problems that we've been identifying here today.
Yes, next.
Yes, I'm Brian Wilson. I'm from Seattle. I wanted to direct my question to Mr. Steinberg. When he had the proposal for the 0.1% tax on derivative markets, I was wondering maybe it would be better for 1% tax on that. And they have use half that money for the state government so they can actually have a budget.
You know, Lynn has a tremendous knack for how to turn the flank. And you start talking about big taxes like one whole percentage point, and people are going to start to see, gee, that's too much. This guy's in favor of more taxes on us. You know, what difference does 0.1% make? So, you know, let's just go ahead and do it at that level. As I say, we're talking about generating new revenues based on taxing parasites of approximately, and this is a minimal guesstimate, $1 billion a day. The consequence of that is that these people are going to go running out of that business, and we're going to start drying up exactly these kinds of parasitical, usurious, derivative, illegal operations that have captured and destroyed our economy. That's really the critical thing. You want to push the idea of a 1% tax? Let's discuss it out. I don't have any problem with that either.
Yes, next.
I would like to make a proposal that since this program has emphasized, in effect, a celebration of life and is opposed to the philosophy of pessimism, that you consider a book of poetry which would celebrate life. And I have an example because I think it deals in great part with some of the things that Kathleen Klonetsky was talking about the attack on the elderly or the infirm. And it's very brief, but I think it will support my question better if I read it. It's by a black poet from Detroit named Dudley Randall, and it appeared in a privately published book, The Lotus Press in Detroit, 1981. And it's to the mercy killers. If ever mercy move you murder me, I pray you, kindly killer, let me live. Never conspire with death to set me free, but let me know such life as pain can give. Even though I be a clot, an aching clench, a stub, a stump, a butt, a scab, a knob, a screaming pain, a putrefying stench, still let me live, so long as life shall throb, even though I turn such traitor to myself as beg to die, do not accomplish me. Even though I seem not human, a mute self, self of glucose, bottled blood, machinery to swell the lung and pump the heart, even so, do not put out my life. Let me still glow. My suggestion is that there be considered a book of poetry that celebrates life right from the earliest, including the Psalms and the Proverbs right up to modern times, of the best of poetry that celebrates life. And I think it would be worthy of publication. And it would be unique because I don't think anyone else would publish such a book.
Just one brief announcement before the final question, which is, will Denise Henderson come to the front of the podium to meet Mel Klonetsky? Next question.
Okay. It's more, what I have to say is more of a statement than a question in regards to the so-called Rainbow Coalition. The original purpose of this, which was really not the Rainbow Coalition, but the curriculum of inclusion, which the purpose was to correct the omissions and incorrect statements of history that were taught to the children. The people originally who originated this idea, I know two of them, did not originally put in about homosexuals. This was not to establish people to love and get used to the life of homosexuals and gays and so on. It was to teach young children tolerance. Somehow, Mr. Fernandez, who was already run out of another state because he ruined their educational system, was gotten to. And certain people who did not want the Rainbow Coalition instituted got to him, and of 400 pages of the curriculum of inclusion, two paragraphs were added by people who were not the originators of the curriculum of inclusion, because they decided, what can we do to wipe this out? What can we add that people would not like it? And that was, they preyed on homophobic people, people who had problems with the sexual aspect. Teaching the children of condoms was only to be started in the seventh grade, and as many of us know, there are children, 10 and 11 year olds, who have babies anyway. And I don't want people to really get the idea that that is all that the so-called Rainbow Coalition, which was not Rainbow Curriculum, which was not the original title or purpose of this program.
I mean, I'd just like to say a few things. There's nothing wrong with tolerance. I mean, we should all be tolerant, but it depends on what you're tolerant of. I mean, I don't think that kids should be given condoms in the schools. I don't think it's a proper function of the school. I think that children of the age of 10 or 11 have children because of the cultural pessimism that pervades the society. They don't really have hope. I mean, I think as you see with this NORPLANT, the push for NORPLANT in Baltimore and other places, that this is a policy of deliberate genocide. And I don't think we should tolerate that. I don't think we should tolerate teaching kids that environmentalism is right, or that zero growth is right, or that if you're over 65, you should drop dead. I don't think that's tolerance.